Many facets of a woman. I would welcome on stage our next upcoming panel, Rashmi Saksena, Dr. Seema Anand, Farah Ghuznavi, and chair of the session, Nazia Erum, along with Kiran Mandral. Rashmi is a veteran journalist, a former crime reporter. From being the first crime reporter, she moved on to cover politics, foreign affairs, besides gender issues. She's done challenging assignments that includes elections, insurgencies, international events, women-related topics, and covering the surrender of dacoits. Farah is a writer, translator, and development worker with a first book named as Fragments of River Song. Her work has been appeared in USA, Britain, France, German, Canada, and Nigeria. Farah has been writing in residence with Commonwealth writers and contributed to BBC series, The Essay. Seema is a London-based mythologist and a practicing storyteller. Seema lectures on Kama Sutra and is an acknowledged authority on Eastern erotology. Nazia is the author of critically acclaimed and hard-hitting book, Mothering a Muslim, which opened primetime discussions on telly and front-page headlines in the newspapers. She writes on cross-section of genders, interfaith, and politics. Kiran is an author. She writes on gender issues. I would like a huge round of applause for the panel. Yeah. Our fourth speaker, Farah, will be shortly joining us in a while.
Thank you for that. Growing up, I think I had some of those same experiences as many of the women here. Grown up on the same sexist jokes, had the same role models that we would keep trying to find around us. In fact, today, the headlines, Mary Kom wins a 6th gold medal. Can we have a round of applause for that, first of all? So growing up, there were various do's and don'ts. And navigating your way around those was not really a very easy task. How do you find what you're supposed to do? Because as a woman, there was always guidelines available. There's always a ticker in your head that's going on. I have like many identities. I'm from Allahabad, so being Allahabadi is one of my identities. Not a very important identity, but it's there. I'm a mother, it's an important identity. I am a Muslim, it's one of those identities. A very important identity is being an Indian for me. But the one that does not leave you at any moment is that of being a woman. As I said, it's a ticker in your head that goes on. So today, the panel I am very proud to share is one that will talk about the various facets of women. Farah, just starting off.
What do you mean that we're not always on time despite our best intentions? Sorry about that.
Well, we're glad. So we're just starting off. So the various facets of women are ones, there are many that we believe, we channelize, and ones that we like to hide. I think I'm more interested in the ones that we hide probably today. So I'll start off from this end. Seema, tell me, personally speaking, what are the ones that you feel have always been culturally fine to express, and the ones that you believe were a bit more difficult to call on?
I know. No, it's okay. We've got mic. Okay, so traditionally, I guess I didn't grow up in a regular kind of family. So I have a really strange background, which makes the question a little bit unusual because, so let me start by saying that, so my great-grandmother, my nani's mother, was very highly educated. She was a working woman and she was a social activist. And she used to, one of her things was she used to fight against domestic violence. So women's rights and violence against women. And she actually died leading a demonstration. Her daughter, my nani, she was one of four, and again, they were all very educated, and my nani and her youngest sister were medics. The other two were principals of colleges and so on. So, you know, there was this whole thing about they'd all had love marriages. My nani's younger sister would manage to get divorced and then lived with the next guy that she didn't marry till much later. And this is before I was born. Then comes my mother, who gets divorced when she's pregnant with me. And then meets my first stepfather, who happens to be an Arab. And they live together, so they, you know, and I'm now 56, and they met when I was one. And this is in Delhi. So when I'm born into this family, I don't realize that there is a gender issue till I step out into the real world. And when I go out into the real world, I suddenly discover that actually I'm not supposed to be what I've been brought up to be, because it's like, no, that's all wrong. So I spent most of my life fighting against my gender equality and trying to fit in with the things, because, you know, there's this desperate need to fit in. So I literally rebelled into academia. I rebelled into monogamy. I've been married for 35 years now to the same man. Bloody hell. It's a first in the family. My mother's really cool. She's had three husbands. I'm still on one. But I rebelled into being a teetotaler and a non-smoker. You know, so yeah, I have a slightly weird and set of identities that I bring to my life.
So we come from totally polar opposite families. My family comes from a very conservative background, where I remember my mother sharing stories of how she would travel to a school in a rickshaw that was covered from everywhere, from all around, so that, you know, parday rahes. So coming from that background, a lot of times I was asked, you know, how do you speak out? How did you be who you are? I think it was something very small that my mother did. It was something so tiny that it took me some time to realize what it was. So I have a brother who's 5 years elder to me. So my mother, while growing up, all through my years, while doing the dinner table, she would ask me to do the plates, to lay down the plates, and she would ask my brother to lay down the glasses. If I'm doing the spoons, he would do the water. So, you know, there was an equal division of labor. And I think that small nuance, something as tiny as that, I think that is where that equality kind of fit in into my head. So, but I was very aware of the inequalities out there. So, you know, I think we come from two totally polar opposite families, which is very interesting.
And I have to just add that Rashmi actually just reminded me that she found the pandit for my shadi when I got married. So maybe that was something to do with
that
you.
That has lasted so long.
For you. So Rashmi, you have been the first woman out there to get into crime journalism.
You have also been silent.
So,
thank you.
So being the first woman out there, that is some barriers breaking. Can you tell us, can you take us back to that
time? Just to go back to where you people started from, I come from a family of bureaucrats, which in my days was called brown sahabs, you know. And I grew up in an environment where, we were, how would I say it? There was really no gender issue in my family for two reasons. One, that because of the civil service background, where my mother was, smoked with a, you know, that long holder. And I remember my first introduction to something which was called shandy, it was, you prepared for the New Year's dance and Christmas. It was very brown sahab culture. But also because of the community I come from, where education is taken for granted, you know. And the only thing they would say in my community was that not only should the woman, I come from the Kaist community of Lucknow, where they said that not only should she know how to read and write and do everything, but she should also know how to sing and dance and cook. I mean, you know, so it was like this fusion. And I grew up in this sort of a thing, being both, trying to straddle both the worlds. But it's basically my father, and hats off to him, who sort of drilled into me. I'm the eldest in my family, followed by a sister, and then I have a younger brother. Youngest sibling is the brother. Who drilled into me that there was no such thing as, I mean, we never spoke about gender in that sense. It was always, you can achieve this because, you know, we've given you the education, or we are giving you the education, so you'll be able to do this. And if it was left to my mother, maybe she would have pulled me back a little bit more, but it was my father who has always propelled me to push the boundary. But the only thing he told me, don't ever do anything which you are ashamed of. He didn't say which I will be ashamed of, or your mother or your family. So somewhere, you know, I grew up thinking that I'm only answerable to myself and not to anybody else. And in my community, even in those days, women got married, which was considered late, 20, you know. So when I started my education and came to college, I did literature. And everybody was telling me, okay, now you have to take the civil service exam. But that was the pattern that was followed. And I told my father, look, I don't want to take the civil service. And he said, why? And I think that was the feeling in me to do something different. I didn't want to follow a set pattern. And I could do it because I was encouraged by my family. They never said no. And I think that is the most important thing, that what happens at home, it really helps you to achieve. And sometimes it helps you to identify what you want to achieve. That also is very important. I was barely 16, and I know I must have been 18. I was still in second year college doing English literature. And I'm talking about 68, I think before most of you were born. That, you know, we used to have these people who came from Air India scouting for women they wanted to recruit for air hostesses. And I was thrilled that I had been recruited. I mean, what more does an 18-year-old want? And I came home so happy, and I told my father that, look, you know, I've got this offer and I'm going. He said, sure, go. But remember one thing. Now you've decided that you're going to make your face your fortune. And think what will happen after a few years when, you know, all this will be on the decline. So what will you tell me at that time? What is your achievement? I mean, this was his way of actually propelling you into thinking the way he actually thought, without you being having to rebel, you know. Having said that, I don't think that it would have been too bad a choice, but whatever. So even when I entered journalism, there were no women reporters. I'm talking about 1971. And it was never an issue with my family that, you know, I was entering into a place where there were no women. It was a male bastion, and people, so women
from
just
an all-female bastion, from an A hostess.
Yeah, I mean,
how did this?
But I didn't realize that I was making that this thing. It was, you know, I was struck by the fact that, okay, my face is my fortune, but what am I going to do after 10 years? What will I do when, you know, 10 years later I may not be considered attractive at all, and where would I have reached? So I even remember telling my father, but I want to see the world. He said, yeah, you can see the world by doing other things also, you know. You can be invited to places. I remember him telling me this, you know. So the only thing my mother said when I got my job, my first job with Hindustan Times in 1971, he said, but you should come home before sunset. That was the only thing. And I said, no, but my work begins, you know, really after 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, how can I come home? And I remember it was a dining table, we were sitting down for dinner. And I said, why do you say that I should come home before sunset? What is it that I can't do during the day, which I would do only after sunset? And I remember my mother getting up and saying, when you speak, at least you should see that your father is also sitting there. You know, it was like, our instructions were given in a very sort of a way in which the boundaries were set for you, but you were also allowed to challenge that boundary. And I think that is what helped me to become whatever little I have achieved in life.
That's very interesting. Kiran, coming to you. So what are these boundaries? As in, what has that been, that internal and external Lakshman Rekha that you have been fighting with or negotiating?
Nazia, Rashmi's story about her father touched a chord with me. Let me go back to that, because I was around 18 and Cathay Pacific had the ads out for air hostesses. My father had died when I was 9 years old. So my mother raised me as a single mom, and she had her own fights. I mean, that's another long story and I don't want to bore all of you. But at that point, my mother told me, do you want to spend the rest of your life serving people? Which is not to put down the profession, but she said, you are capable of so much more. Why would you want to do that? And what happens after a few years? The same question that your father asked you. What happens after a few years? What would you do then? Nazia, at that point, I was an English literature student. My mother had been a teacher. My father was a bank officer. He died too young. He was the one who put the love for books into me, and I was the one who was encouraged to read and not to get into the kitchen. So I cook. I can feed a starving family, but I don't choose to do it.
Is it rare to be allowed with books and not with? How many hands here for who share her experiences?
I was not told that you need to learn to cook or you need to learn to manage the house or you need to do anything. This is, you know, I'm old. I'm like,
it's a minority. The hands are a minority.
You know, so this was back in the 70s and 80s when I grew up. I think I still battle with that now because I'm completely undomesticated. I have no domestic skills worth talking about, and I think they're essential survival skills now. But I do see, Nazia, that there's so much that you get judged for if you're not a woman who has some interest in the domestic.
What do you mean by you are judged for it?
Take something as simple as a tiffin box. My son, God bless his soul, has never told me, but he goes with a jam sandwich every day. And something else, maybe a paratha, or there are two tiffin boxes. So that one jam sandwich or that one peanut butter sandwich is fixed because I can't be bothered to be thinking about what to make. So someone in his school or his playground was teasing him. Your mother sends a jam sandwich every day. So he was young at this time, he was in the fifth or the sixth. He says, my mother writes books. She's not going to be making jam sandwiches.
Playground of course.
So to me, it was a matter of great shame because some other mother came and told me, this is what your son told my son. And
but
I was like,
be proud of him.
And I was like, oh my God, even my tiffin boxes are being judged now by children. So these are the various things that I think a woman, you know, it was never that your father would pack your tiffin box and your father is, why is your father not packing? It is the mother who will pack the tiffin box, and it is the mother who will get judged for sending the same thing every single day, which I think is something we still, the fact that a young kid has said this, I feel sorry that the kids are still carrying the prejudices on.
So do you think these experiences are universal, Farah?
I think they might be universal for those of us who haven't maybe trod the expected path. And I think there are many people out there who haven't, and I think most of the people on this stage would also claim that, either consciously or otherwise. And there's so many things that you guys have said that I can relate to at various levels. I hope I can just pick up on a few things. Like what you were saying, Seema, about your dad. I always say that I was raised by a feminist father and an activist mother, and it showed. And it showed in my school, which was Holy Cross in Dhaka, which is sort of like Loreto Convent. I'm sure you guys have a sense of what, you know, discipline is the watchword and you're expected to do what you're told and so on. By and large, I did what I was told. I was not a natural rebel per se, but, you know, what they were telling me to do so often conflicted with what I saw at home or what I had imbibed in a way. Like you're saying, it's not that you're told this, it's you're shown it by example. And if you question certain things, you know, it comes up like that. So for me, at a very early stage, I started getting into trouble because I had a lot of male older cousins. And they somehow, I look back on this now in terms of unconscious gender roles, you know, they somehow realized that it really bothered me to be bossed around. So what did they do? They bossed me around. Farah, go and get a glass of water. No. What do you mean, no? You're the youngest, you go get the glass of water. You know, constantly. And it was, it kind of really, and my mother said, why do you let it bug you? Just, you know, either give it to them or just say no. But it really, really bothered me. And it took me a long time to understand what was bothering me. I was too young when it started, you know, 7, 8, whatever. Now, this continued as a theme in school because we had domestic science in those days. I don't know if you guys still have it. And we were supposed to learn how to basically cook, sew, and something very ambiguous, which was how to have a happy home. And this was the sort of study part of it. You know, there's the practical and the study. So, you know, that we literally answered questions, and I'm sure none of you are aware of this, but how to have a happy home is to make sure your home was always clean, your children are always clean, and your husband is always smiling, okay? And this is kind of a tall order, I think, at the best of times. But the methods we were taught were not, I think, I'm not sure they would really work, other than the dal should not be too cold. So, you know, I somehow, and that was the stage where it started for me. I think unconsciously I decided if this is what I was expected to do, and we had this awful domestic science teacher who loathed me, poor lady, I think I made her life miserable. And so I decided I was not going to pass domestic science. And luckily for me, it was not one of the, you know, official subjects, so therefore mandatory. So it was mandatory to take, but not to pass it. So for 12 semesters, 3 years in a row, I had an unblemished record of failure, except for one term where unfortunately my mother had sewn something. I don't know why she did it, because she's also not known for this kind of thing. And that got me a passing grade. Otherwise, nowhere did I manage to do this. And this kind of continued also in my, I went into development work. I've come to writing by a very circuitous path, but went into development work. I worked for a place called Grameen Bank. Some of you may have heard of it. And it's very well known for giving microfinance loans to poor women. And approximately 95%, maybe by now 100% of the people who get the loans, at least on paper, are women. What is much less advertised is the fact that about 90% of the staff are men. So when I went into that organization as a young woman, it was quite a shock in terms of sort of hierarchies and so on and so forth. And it was very interesting also, because again, I found that like school, I was effortlessly offensive. You know, I know this is a little bit radical. I didn't think it was always necessary to wear a dupatta. My clothes were very loose. They were always high-necked, you know. I really didn't think. It actually got me banned off the training institute grounds, because at that time the training institute was being run by something of a martinet. I don't think I could have done it now either, but I did pull off 3.5 years of going into the office without the dupatta. When I went to the field, I always made sure I had it, because there it was a different, you know, I wanted people to interact properly and so on. So it was very interesting. And I think some of you may have heard of Begum Rokeya Sakawat Hussain. My great-great-grandmother was her older sister, Karimunnesa Khanum. So unfortunately, the taint in the blood, so to speak, has been there for a very long time ago. And the other thing here, speaking of fathers, is that in my school, you know, it was a girls' school, so you had about 1,000 students, and when you had the parents attending for sports day or prize giving or whatever, I was not good at sports. English was about the only time I ever got a prize. But my parents decided between them that my father would be the one coming to the school. So my mother sat me down very kindly and said, I hope you don't mind. Don't be upset. Papa wants to do it. I don't really like this kind of stuff. Is it okay? It's like, I don't care, you know. So my father would come in, and he's a very, very gentle, very personable fellow. He would come in. The teachers adored him. And then after every parent-teacher conference, I would get this lecture, your father is such a nice man. Why don't you try harder, you know? And then, but on the other hand, I also overheard them talking, and they were saying, there was an incident in my domestic science class, obviously, domestic science, and I overheard them saying, what do you expect? Her mother never comes to the school. Ki hobe, ma to kono din ashe na. You know, so immediately this idea of that I was modeling bad behavior, and actually what happened in that incident was that it was some sewing thing, and I had forgotten my needle. You know, I mean, it's amazing I even showed up to the class, frankly, but I'd forgotten my needle. I asked for the extra needle, and I held out my left hand. As you know, this is also not a wise thing to do. And the teacher actually stuck the needle into my hand. I mean, not very hard, but she did. And it was a little bit of a shock, you know? So I kind of looked at it, and then I looked at her. And then I held up the hand so that the other 49 girls could see it. And then I just walked out of the class. Didn't ask permission, nothing. Stayed outside until the class was over. So that really caused a riot in the teacher's room in terms of disobedience. And half of them liked me, and the other half didn't. So you know, anything that I was doing that, you know, kind of came under bad behavior was basically blamed on my poor mother, who, you know, who does know how to sew and is a very reluctant cook. And like you, the last thing I would like to say here is that partly, I think, as a result of that experience, I decided that if the idea was supposed to be that you look pretty, you dress in a certain way, and you cook and you sew, I was not going to look pretty, I was not going to dress like they wanted, and I was certainly not going to cook and sew. So it wasn't until I was 30 that I actually discovered that I like cooking, that it's very relaxing, and it's a damn good skill, especially if you spend some time overseas, when everyone is terribly grateful if you invite them over for dinner and make something, you know? So it's I think it does begin at home, and I think the paths you take, some of them are conscious and some of them are unconscious. And it's interesting to look back and see how it plays out.
I think one thing that has not yet been spelled across is the one common factor that is supposed to hold you back, and that is a woman's sexuality. We as Indians are really, really great at, you know, putting things under the carpet. Especially when it comes around sex. Seema. You are the person to go to this for. You have extensively worked around this.
I just because it's something I'm going to say later, I'm going to say this right now, just to start it. It reminded me, so when my son was a little kid in school, and they were one day told to make a drawing of mummy doing something. So all the kids did mummy hoovering, mummy cooking. My son did mummy wearing perfume. Yeah, unfortunately, this has been, obviously, there's a thread running through here. Okay, so my work on erotica started in a very serious vein, I have to say. I look at women's stories, I look at women's narratives, because I believe that the stories that we tell actually establish our identity. So, you know, if you tell stories of how the man comes home and he beats up his wife and she's so good, she's so good, she never says anything, wo to devi hai, then that's what you expect the woman to be. That, you know, no matter what happens to her, she's always going to be quiet. So the stories that you tell establish your identity. And if you want to create change, real change, it's the stories that need to be changed. And as I studied this, I found that we never ever looked at the stories of a woman's right to her own sexuality, her own body. That was always property. So I went backwards to see where we had actually lost out on these stories, which took me into the erotic literatures of ancient India, which I have to say are fabulous. If you people haven't actually explored, you know, Indian erotica is the most beautiful, it's the most refined, it's the most elegant erotica in the world. It is gorgeous. Ooh. Yes. Who is right? And so I went into that thinking, yeah, typical, you know, hubris, like, oh, I'll do a 15,000 word essay and then we'll move on. 10 years later, I'm still with it because it is absolutely fabulous. It really, truly is. Because I discovered that the Kama Sutra, that is just this horribly vilified book, is actually not quite what we think it is. The Kama Sutra is the very first book in the world to actually give women an equal status on something. It is actually the very first book. And the only reason that it became really, really special or important was because this is the first time in the history of mankind where somebody says, so till then, it has been believed that women don't have an independent source of pleasure, that their pleasure depends on the pleasure of the man. Vatsyayan comes along and he says, not only do women have an independent source of pleasure, but that they don't even need a man for it. And it was so controversial at that point that it put the book on the map. But you know, this is a book that actually, it has no misogynistic, when I say no misogynistic language, it's not a feminist book like we think of feminism today, but as close to it as you can get. So it's not got abusive language, it's got beautiful language, it gives the woman the right to be the aggressor, the right to be the one who starts. It's consent on a different level altogether. And it is absolutely amazing. Like I said, I got more and more into it because then I discovered that actually the Kama Sutra never talks about the act of sex. It only talks about seduction. It talks about positions and things. But you know, it inspired the next 1500 years worth of literature. So all of our Sanskrit and Tamil literature written till the 1800s comes from the Kama Sutra, for instance. And when I said it's very refined and so on, it comes from the metaphors. So for instance, in ancient world, not just in ancient India, a woman was not allowed to be on top during lovemaking. Okay, so in the Christian mythologies, it is completely forbidden. Adam's first consort, somebody called Lilith, actually decided that she could be on top. She was equal to him. And she's thrown out of paradise and she's now a demoness in Christian mythology. The Kama Sutra says you could be on top if you were very good at what you did. And being very good meant, ladies and gentlemen, that you had to be able to bring your partner to orgasm by only moving your hips. You didn't move the rest of your torso. So women would wear jingling girdles, lots of gungrus on their upper waist, and make sure that the gungrus didn't make a sound. My knees couldn't take it. Okay. But anyway, so in the literature later that follows, they never ever, it's a lot of erotic literature, they never ever say, and then she climbed up on top and then she humped away. They never, they would just say she put on her jingling girdle and you knew exactly what was going to happen. Or the fact that, you know, you had to wear different perfume, which is why I was talking about the perfume. Different perfume on different parts of your body. So every little bit had a different perfume, which I'm not going to go into right now. But there's this whole story about when you leave your perfume on your lover, it's not quite as simple as just which perfume gets left on what part of him. All about what you've been doing. So it truly is. I mean, I've actually gone into this whole idea of the erotica, the sensuality, the sexuality, because it is just to recognize it within yourself is the most empowering thing, I think, that you can do for yourself. And I really, really think that this is the one book that can sort out the gender issue of the dysfunctionality in this country. So I really, really want to bring this back to us.
I'll come to you, Kiran. Because you were writing a column on Indian women and sexuality. And how do you think, whatever Seema has just shared with us, how do you see that playing out in the Indian scenario? How do you think it has, or is not playing out?
Actually, it was on the middle-aged woman and her sexuality, because I think a lot of us in the country feel that once you cross 40, you might as well put yourself up on a shelf to dry and, you know, every body part atrophies and nothing
go
happens.
Go into the Devi mode.
Yeah. You go from productive, reproductive into a Maji mode. And there's nothing in between. There's no cross. But when you are 40, that is the point, I think, and every woman, most women would agree with me, is when your libido does get the strongest. You are not prepared at all for this expectation that by now you have to make way and not be interested in sex anymore, because you've crossed a certain age and menopause is there saying, hi, time for you, for your ovaries to shrivel up. No, but that doesn't happen. Maybe it's the last shot at your body getting its last baby. So I wrote this column for DNA for the longest time, and it was about middle-aged women and how they are perceived as sexual creatures. As you know, a woman who is older than a man is called a cougar. And a woman who wants sex more than a man is called a nymphomaniac. So a woman's sexuality is constantly rationed. And talking about it makes you even more vulnerable to the, I wouldn't say expectation, I think it's a certain tarring that happens. If you talk about sex, means you have loose morals. That's not it. Sexuality is different. Morals are different. Everything is different. I think these nuances are what we don't really understand and appreciate. So I would write about something as simple as polyamory, and then my poor husband would get a call from his friend, Bhabhi ji ne aaj ek bada interesting column likha. Like, hello? No, that's not happening. So we need to talk about these things. We need to, I feel that our reluctance to talk about sexuality and women is that we are frightened of women's sexuality. As a people, we are frightened of how powerful women can be when they are fully awakened as sexual creatures, when they accept the fact. I mean, how many women accept or demand an orgasm as an equal right. We don't, most of us. I know of some friends who are like grateful if they get an orgasm. No, it's your birthright. You have to demand it. So these sort of conversations are things that I felt should be happening everywhere, not just for the middle-aged woman, but across women. But I don't think, while the women were writing in and saying they loved it, I think there was a battery of equally angered men who were writing into the paper and saying that, no, this is not what a Sabhya family paper should be carrying. So that's what my experience has been, Nazia.
Sabhya family. Rashmi, you have written this brilliant book, She Goes to War.
It's as interesting as the Kama Sutra.
Well, it's got its own. So it talks about women militants in India. You have been a crime journalist for the longest time. So between being a daku and a devi, as this session is very aptly subtitled, do you think a lot of, you know, between them, there are lots of shades between those two. So tell us more about how, in your experience, in your sphere of work, what are the shades that
I
you have seen?
Definitely move to that. But if I can just ask for a minute to dwell on what my
Absolutely.
Other friend said. I have not had the opportunity to intellectualize what you people have been talking about. But there's one conscious decision which I did take when I entered this male bastion and this world of men. And that was my way of proving, not only proving, but telling myself and everyone else who was in this profession, that I am proud of being a woman. I'm going to dress like one. And you have to take me as your equal, not because I smoke or I drink and I wear khaki pants and blue bush shirt or whatever was happening at that time, but because my work is not only as good as yours, it's even better. So my way of proving to them that I could be both, be as feminine as I want, and yet professionally, intellectually, I don't want to sound arrogant, but you know, be as good and even better. And that was one of the reasons I refused to start wearing jeans and trousers and whatever. I continued to wear saris. I continued to do my makeup, which was a big no-no at that time in the world of journalism. And when I really had a very challenging assignment, I always wore red lipstick. I never wore those earthy browns.
Which shade? You
know? And no, that was my way of being very comfortable with my gender, my sexuality and whatever. And if people said, I mean, that was much before the Me Too campaign. And if somebody in my room said, oh, you're dressed, you know, in a very sexy manner. So I would always tell the person, are you uncomfortable? Is it a challenge for you? And, you know, I would make the same sort of comments even to my male colleagues. If they were looking nice, I would say, ay, aaj toh bade hero lag rahe ho tum. Or, you know, so what I'm saying is that this was my way of being who I was in a man's world, which I've seen now. I never made an attempt to sit on the culvert and smoke, and where all journalists smoke, all journalists, men and women, majority of them drink, and I didn't, because I wanted to make that point. It was not a moral issue, but it was an issue that, look, I decide for myself what I want to be, you know. Okay, now, sorry to have gotten to this personal thing, but talking about these assignments which I did, it stems from there. I took assignments which were considered to be a man's assignment. And I had to prove, in fact, my editor asked me, are you going to cover a demonstration wearing sari? So I said, not only will I wear a sari, I will continue to wear my high heels. And I will manage. And believe it or not, I did. Sometimes I had to run and I used to take off my chappals and just, you know, them piche, but run, and I would hitch up my sari and do whatever. The point I'm trying to make is that if you're comfortable with it, your own self, the others will accept you. They have no other choice. And I don't care what they say behind my back. What they say in front of me, I will meet. So my first brush with women, and that who were not towing the so-called line which was set out for them, is when I actually started doing crime reporting. And in the 70s, the police as well as society at large was not comfortable with the idea of a woman being in a world of crime. If you remember, I'm talking way back, there was this famous dacoit called Putli Bai. She was somewhere in the 40s or 50s, you know. And the reason people accepted her, because she was a female version of Robin Hood. So they always had to be the Devi angle. If she's doing this, she's doing it because she's doing it for the poor. It was not that here is this woman who wants to be a dacoit and kill and steal and do whatever because she wants to do it. But, you know, poor little lady, she's doing it for the sake of the poor people. So that is how people were accepting it. For me, I never saw it like that. Okay, my first brush with women criminals were those women who brewed illicit liquor in Delhi. And not only did they brew it, they also sold it. The men never sold it, it was the women. And when I met them and I started off by this whole thing, oh, poor me, you have to do it because you have to feed your children and you have to look after your husband. You know, I also came with all those preconceived notions that a woman, if she's in crime or is doing something, it's because she's been pushed into it for the sake of a larger good, you know. And I remember this woman and she said, I do it to feed everyone, but also to feed myself. And I need to stay alive. And I eat more than the others. I need more strength, you know. And they were happy doing what they were doing. And that's what led me to study these women who had gone into crime as a matter of choice to a great extent. I mean, these were women who could have also washed bartans or washed clothes or done anything, but they had made this conscious decision. And the best part, the strong trait in their character was they took that decision and they did not hold anybody else responsible for that. They took full accountability for what they were doing. And therefore, when I moved on to write this book about women terrorists and militants, it's because I thought here were women who came from very traditional conservative homes and whatever. Most of them did not have the benefit of a formal education. And yet something in their personality was so strong that they had decided to break the mold and come out. And they were very comfortable with what they were doing. It shattered this image of what society as a whole is comfortable with what they think a woman should be. You know, they're always saying, no, no, no. When I started this book, everybody told me, this security agencies and everybody, madam, you know, these are not women who go because they want to. Half of them have been abducted or raped or kidnapped and, you know, they need money. So they are pushed into it. But my book tells you it's not so. They have various other reasons. And I always write about women who I feel are pushing the boundary and doing something different. Right or wrong is not for me to judge.
Sometimes I feel that, you know, even women, as women, we don't, we ourselves are made to think in a particular way that women have to be like this. I remember visiting my school after like 15 years, and I go back to my favorite teacher, and you know, there's a reunion happening, I was a favorite student, and the first thing she asked me, so are you married, how many kids? She didn't even come to what was I doing, and I felt so let down. I want you to tell us about, does this change, because you have seen from bottom up, does this change, this experience of being let down by everybody around you for women?
Well, I mean, I think that's a difficult one because everyone around you is a very generic group. But I think one of the things I would like to say, and I can see that there are signals coming our way, so I'll try and be brief. On this issue of sexuality, going back very quickly, one of the things that's very interesting to me is that we talk about women's, you know, like in 2018, many people will feel that sexuality or your sex life per se is a private matter. And I think most people can relate to that, and I think that's fair enough. What I find very interesting in South Asia is that there are two things that come with this. One is that women, as you said, are supposed to have no sexuality. And the second is if there is any suspicion of any kind, a woman's sexuality becomes a very public matter. You know, everyone has an opinion on it. Everyone can say something about it. Whether it's true or not, whether it's, you know, that's kind of irrelevant. And one of the things that I found in my work, especially with Grameen, and it's one of the things that started me writing fiction, because I felt that a lot of the stories tend to be a little bit one-dimensional. You know, there's a lot of misery, there's a lot of... And all of that is true, and we can also incorporate that. But there are many people who rise above it at, you know, with no particular advantage. They're the natural leaders that you talked about. There are people who, you know, there are just some people, women and men, whose spirit cannot be broken. And it's really interesting to see that kind of coming out. So one of the things that I found, for example, when I was working at this job was that the idea of a woman's sexuality or sexual pleasure is non-existent. You marry because basically, A, you're expected to, and secondly, there's a financial aspect to it. So when I was going to these village women's meetings, and I made sure that actually the branch people were not there, so I would have private conversations with them. And of course, the first question, as you said, is, are you married? Do you have children? If not, why not? You know, and I went through variations of this for 3.5, more than that, years. And so what was interesting was, again, within that, you will find somebody who is not actually a rebel, but thinks a little bit differently. So we had this discussion, and they were saying to me, I was 25 at that time, they said, you better hurry up, you know, you don't have much time left. So they said, why are you not married? And I was trying to go into that very slightly, you know, urban explanation of I haven't found the right person. It wasn't going down very well. And then they said, well, one of them suddenly said, do you earn enough to support yourself? So I said, yes. And she turned to the others and she said, she doesn't need to get married. It was that simple. It was not a matter of sexuality. It was a matter of finance. And then came the social aspect. And somebody else said, well, she doesn't have children. She needs a man to have children. And another one said, this is not all at the same meeting, said, if you're earning well, then you can buy yourself a good man, she said. Buy yourself a good man, right? And I was like, this was all kind of, I wasn't really participating. I was being told all this. Excellent advice from women 20 years older. And then the final thing she said, and if you can't find, one of them said, if you can't find a good, good men are all taken, she said, they don't want 25-year-olds. So if you can't find a good man, then you find one, jo chalega, you have your children, and then you let him go. Huh? And then you'll be fine, you look after your children, you'll be okay. So it was very interesting to me, because most of these women were not, by any standard, particularly educated or particularly, you know, encouraged to be social rebels. It's a very logical kind of approach within their wider context. So I think also in the stories that I write, one of the things, unconscious themes, I think, is to look at, you know, you have, let's say, random example, and actually this is another thing that feeds into sexuality, is violence, which is so prevalent in across the world, I think, not just in our part of the world, but it's something we don't talk about. It's something we certainly don't talk about in the context of how it impacts a woman's sexuality, you know, or how you approach these, you know, a marriage or any kind of sexual relationship after something like that happens. Yet, you know, 2/3, I would say, more than 50%, I think even research has shown, have had some kind of unpleasant brush of this nature with somebody. So, you know, to look at the stories, to give you an example, I think if you look at domestic violence, very many women will stay in a bad relationship or an abusive, emotionally abusive relationship. And they have their reasons for doing it. I'm not questioning that. There are, you know, certain psychological changes also take place. But you will always find the one or two women who find another way or make a different decision. And again, it's not about education, and it's not always about opportunity either. It's a way of thinking, which I think is really interesting. So for me, the stories are about that 9th or 10th person. And not, there are men as well as women in my stories, also told in a male voice, but what makes them different? It fascinates me. What makes them different? What makes them able to, you know, do something that the other people within their social circle or whatever just don't think of, or perhaps have the courage to, or so on. And I think for me, a lot of that hope, and I've seen it in Bangladesh in women of all classes, of, and you know, men who also don't think like the standard men, you know, like my father, for example, my brother, and other men that I met, they to me are the hope for the future. They are the ones, those outliers I'm looking forward to the day that those outliers move more to the center, and you know, we see more and more of them, and I think that is when we will see real social change coming, which I hope all of us can be part of.
Fantastic. You know, I would love to end this on hope, because I do see a lot of hope when I see the next generation, because they are growing up so remarkably different from how our childhood was. They are, with a lot of, they're growing up with a different set of notions of equality. They are watching stuff that is now much more on, you know, my five-year-old watches Frozen, Elsa, and you know, strong characters, Tangled, Rapunzel, and Mulan, and there's such wonderful stories for them. And she, whenever she, there's a movie ending, she asks me, who saved whom? I say, both of them saved each other, let's not, you know. So I see a lot of hope when I see this next generation, and let's end it at hope. And here's to all women out there. Thank you.